Coming up, how lower carbon hydrogen could clean up heavy industry.
No one's done this anywhere before.
How to get it to that industry.
It's a giant vacuum flask.
And what a hydrogen-powered future could look like.
We can transform our energy systems for good.
In the UK, where the Industrial Revolution began, a new revolution is underway. Cement. Few other materials have played a greater role in building our modern world. But cement production comes at a massive environmental cost. It's responsible for around 7% of all global carbon dioxide emissions.
But here in the north of England, this cement manufacturing plant, Hanson, has proved that hydrogen could help clean up the industry.
To make cement, you need a lot of fuel to heat crushed limestone in a rotating kiln at 2,000 degrees Celsius. Currently, the world over, that fuel is fossil fuel, which, as we all know, emits carbon dioxide when it's burnt. But in 2021, this man finally proved hydrogen could be one of the answers to reducing carbon dioxide emissions from cement production.
So obviously people had thought about this before, but nobody had done it. Did people think you were crazy?
Never been done anywhere in the world before. Yeah, world first.
Ian found a way to replace fossil fuels with a fuel mix of hydrogen and biomass, waste material from plants and animals.
How did you feel when you realised that this experiment worked?
I still can't put it to words now. I think I went through sort of all those emotions around, is it going to work, and nervousness. When it actually happened and the controller said, right, I've done it, I sort of teared up and I thought, you know, something really big here. We got to the point where we could have actually increased the production on the kiln with the extra heat we're getting from the hydrogen. The kiln controllers loved it. You know, they'd have it every day if they could.
So if it was so successful, why not run hydrogen every day?
Were you burning 100% hydrogen?
No, we burnt around about 40% of the main burner was from hydrogen. If we wanted to burn 100% hydrogen, then we would have needed the entire UK hydrogen production to do that demonstration.
Right, okay.
With sufficient supply, things could change overnight.
We would use the hydrogen and the biomass, and that would replace all our current fuel mix.
So all the fuel mix?
All the fuel mix. I think there'd be any need for any coal, any other fossil fuels.
Tackling emissions from cement production is one of the biggest challenges that we face if we want to decarbonise. But the experiments they've been doing here with hydrogen prove that the potential is there.
But getting enough hydrogen generated from renewable sources to energy-hungry industries is a completely different challenge. Japan and Kobe, one of the country's busiest ports. Japan's successes have been built on industry and they've been built on manufacture. But of course, that comes with consequences because Japan is now the fifth largest emitter of CO2. Making low-carbon hydrogen a viable energy option for industries around the world means finding ways of transporting hydrogen from where it's produced to where it's needed most, like Japan, an industrial superpower.
I'm standing on the very, very first hydrogen-carrying ship ever built.
This is the 8,000-ton Suiso Frontier, the result of efforts by Shell, its partners, and the Japanese government. It's a first step towards moving large volumes of liquid hydrogen safely around the planet.
Captain Dundee.
Hey,
Hello,
good to see you. Welcome aboard.
Thank you very much for having me aboard. It's a pleasure to be here. Tell me a little bit about it.
Oh, well, OK. She can actually carry 1,250 cubic metres of liquefied hydrogen, and that's at minus 253 degrees Celsius. Quite something.
Minus 253 degrees is around three times colder than the lowest temperature ever recorded in Antarctica. Chilling hydrogen to this temperature changes it from a gas to a liquid. And because liquid hydrogen takes up less storage space than hydrogen gas, you can transport more of it.
So how do you keep it so cold?
It's nothing more than maybe something like this, you know. It's a giant vacuum flask.
To understand how you upscale this everyday item to transport liquid hydrogen across the ocean, we need to take a closer look inside. Secured in the hull, a vast tank holds thousands of litres of chilled liquid hydrogen. To keep the hydrogen supercooled and stable at minus 253 degrees Celsius, a vacuum surrounds the tank, created between an inner and outer stainless steel skin, the same way an everyday vacuum flask works.
Old-fashioned technology.
Old-fashioned technology, only 1.3 million times as big as this one.
And with a test voyage completed between Australia and Japan, the Swisso Frontier has already proven this technology works.
With the experience we've had so far, we've been able to prove that this cargo tank design is really good, and it can hold the temperatures and pressures for at least 21 days.
Here's my big question. We know that this works from an engineering point of view, from a technical point of view. What, in your personal opinion, do you think the future is going to be?
I think we should be looking at a lot more hydrogen vessels, a lot more liquefied hydrogen vessels, which can probably carry 100 times as much cargo as this can.
Wow, 100 times as much as this, like 100 times the size of this. So kind of oil tanker size type things.
This is just the beginning.
That's right.
So far, I've learnt hydrogen could be the key to decarbonising industries like cement.
I think there'd be any need for any coal, any other fossil fuels.
And can be transported to fuel the global energy system.
She can actually carry 1,250 cubic metres of liquefied hydrogen.
But what I want to know is, what do we need to do to actually make it happen? France. And its inspiring capital city.
Here in Paris in 2015, nearly 200 countries made a commitment to limit global temperature rise by 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial levels. And it was that Paris agreement that really sparked into action looking at how hydrogen could help cut emissions and meet those goals.
So is hydrogen part of the answer? And where does hydrogen sit on the road to net zero? I'm meeting Daryl Wilson from the Hydrogen Council to get some answers.
Daryl, nice to see you.
Good to see you.
How are you?
So here we are, hydrogen. It's pretty powerful stuff, isn't it?
For sure, yeah. It's the energy that powers the sun. It's the way we propel rockets to get us to the moon. It's the most abundant element on the face of the Earth.
What do you think the role could be of hydrogen in the energy makeup by 2050? And that's the kind of net zero target that lots of countries are talking about.
At the Hydrogen Council, we're anticipating a huge impact. By replacing fossil fuels with hydrogen, which is made from renewable sources, we have the potential to reduce overall global emissions by approximately 20%.
But it's not going to be easy, is it? You can't just suddenly click your fingers and lo and behold, we've got hydrogen. There are going to be issues.
The cost of hydrogen, safety, infrastructure, policy, regulation, there's many challenges ahead of us. So we need to be talking industry and government, the public sector, civil society, all working together toward the same ends to make sure that we have a consistent approach to our overall decarbonization program.
Whenever anyone does anything new in life, I've noticed, it always tends to be really expensive. And I just wonder where we are cost-wise, and is the cost coming down? Is it still very expensive?
We've been tracking at the Hydrogen Council the cost over the last 5 years, and we've seen it drop by 50% twice already. So there's an accelerating reduction in the cost, which is good to know.
One thing I've noticed about being on this journey is I get that sense of optimism. There is this sense of this is a grand vision. I just wanted to know from where you're standing when you're looking at it, what do you feel about it? Are you optimistic?
Absolutely. And if we can harness the power of hydrogen, we can transform our energy systems in a sustainable way for good.
You're happy about the future, I think.
Absolutely.
It's been an eye-opening adventure. From race cars to trucks, planes, and even heavy industry. I've seen how hydrogen is already helping to meet our energy needs and powering society on the road to achieving net zero.
We face massive challenges as a civilization, but it is amazing to see how creative humans can be and what we can do when we put our minds to it.
If you've enjoyed this, watch the rest of the series here.